So welcome back for session 11 of CEE 120C220C. Today we are going to continue kind of thinking about how we can adapt our structures, kind of change them parametrically, specifically thinking about how they're related to the sun. So we're going to continue with some of the examples we started last time in terms of evaluating the sun directness and then kind of using the vector to the sun to think about like the overhangs on windows and how we can adjust something like that. But we're going to push ahead into another way of looking at things, in that as we think about the sun and how it hits different buildings, going through and just doing a simple vector computation really isn't the most accurate way of looking at things, because it's really based on sort of a specific time of day in a specific, day of the year. It's really only a very isolated snapshot, so it's not really a very fair evaluation. So what we're going to look at today is actually how, moving beyond simple vector calculations, you can actually start to use a broader type of analysis, actually use solar insolation analysis, something we typically do to think about just how much sun is hitting the different surfaces, considering every point in time throughout the entire year. Okay, and average all those values together and use that as an evaluation, as opposed to just a single vector. So just really kind of moving into the whole idea, we're continuing to evaluate elements, but really trying to add a lot more depth and accuracy to it, as opposed to those really simple assumptions, which are great for calculation, but may not be the most accurate. Okay, now as we get going into all this, you might remember that last time we had looked at the whole issue of basically evaluating the panel orientation relative to the sun. So that was all about just kind of computing those vectors and trying to scale the vectors to give us some sort of values. And we looked at how we could map that to either a color or even change some of the panel parameters based on sort of the directions, so that the structure was always adapting to sort of where the sun was in the sky. Okay. And we even looked at a little example of following the sun, where if we move the sun through the sky, a field of solar panels could go ahead and rotate around so the vector was already pointing directly in the direction towards the sun. Okay. Today, we will continue down that path, starting with the overhang, but then move into the sun analysis. But what I want to do is introduce you to assignment 2, just so you can sort of see what that's all about. Okay. So let me go ahead and open it up. If you can on your side, please do. Oh, where am I going to find it? I'm going to find it out there in files or under assignments, either way. But let's take a look at what we have in mind for you. Okay, this one's called Soak Up the Sun. And let's just sort of see what you're going to be working on. The idea is as follows. Okay, so you're going to experiment with the surfaces of a parametric structure to evaluate the directness of the sun, and then ultimately try to figure out how to maximize that. And here are some examples that we've kind of worked on. There's sort of the parametric stadium, where the sun coloring and the size of the apertures was all based on kind of where the sun was in the sky, providing a little bit of visual feedback. Here's something that I actually did kind of would be for your assignment 1 last year, which is like a big concourse. You can sort of see it's kind of a linear structure, has a little bit of a sine wave across the front, kind of similar to the prompt that you used for assignment 1. Okay. So you are going to start by creating a simple parametric structure, and you can create a new structure, or just keep on working with the one that you created for assignment 1. If it's nice and you kind of like it, you want to keep playing with it, go for it. Big criterion as you decide is that you should be able to flex some of the parameters in a way that changes the panel orientation relative to the sun, so that we can flex and evaluate what the impact of that is. Okay? So, like Dom, since you have kind of that kind of wavy structure with a sine wave, thinking about flexing the amplitude of the wave, or even the number of waves, things like that. Lama, you're kind of going more around. We're going to think of something that we can kind of do that would, changing the depth of the curvature or something like that. There'll be something we can play with as one of the parameters if you want to keep working with that structure, or feel free to work on a different one. Okay? No worries. So, for 2 units as you're getting started, everyone's going to go through and just basically do something very similar to what we've been playing during one class. Create a custom node that evaluates the directness of the panels. Okay. And you can use our examples that we've been using as classes as a starting point. I'm all about begging, borrowing, and kind of adapting code that you've seen. Okay. And basically go through and compute some values, we can kind of scale them between 0 and 1. then go through and provide some visual feedback, kind of create some sort of custom node to map it to a color range, override the colors, and even go through and adapt some aspect of the surface panels. That could be if you use like an aperture panel or an opening panel, changing the size of the opening. There's actually some cool panels that I have shared that are out there in the folder where you can change, oh, the peak height of little triangular peaks, or turn on and off a feature. Like there's one panel that has like a solar panel, like a PV panel associated with it. And based on a certain threshold, you could turn the PV panel off or on. Kind of to indicate that you would, if it's a very desirable surface, include the PV panel. But if it wasn't such a desirable surface, you'd omit it and just save some money there. Okay, so it's going to start just with sort of flexing. Okay, you're going to evaluate the solar potential of your structure. What I'd like to do is actually go through and think about not only getting the directness of each of the different panels, but to do an overall value. So go through and you can think about really how you want to compute that. It's a little bit funny about whether you just want to sum up all the values, or another way to think about it is only to consider the values that are positive and try to maximize the positive values. And this is almost like a little theoretical debate we got into last year. It's this whole notion of if you have values that are negative, they're not facing the sun, do you care? Or is it just that you're trying to maximize the positive? It could be either way. Okay. So the idea is to try varying your input parameters and try to find some set of parameters that's going to give you the maximum potential, kind of the best color distribution. So let me pause there. Does that kind of make sense? Okay. For the most part, that part's not too bad. For 3 units, as you keep on going, you're actually going to do something very similar. We're going to play with a node today called the Solar Analysis Package, which really just amps up your game a little bit. It's still your structure, you're still flexing the parameters, but rather than just computing a directness value based on the vectors, we're going to go through and actually do a real analysis of the solar insulation that would hit each of those panels throughout the year. And we'll show you how that works today. It's actually a very cool little node. You set it up properly, it does a very good job of computing those things and giving you some very realistic feedback based on not only your structure, but if you want to think about some other structures which are nearby, which might be shading your structure, or even if parts of your structure shade other parts, it does a very good job of analyzing those things. So you're going to basically download and install this, use the analyze node to compute some values, and then again, compute a total cumulative annual solar insulation. So trying to find what you think is the best values. Once you try to find the best values, then we can set the input values to match those optimal values. And then finally, provide some visual feedback. So it's really very parallel to what you did. It's just you did it with a better evaluator. And for 3 units, we're going to show you again how to move into this today. This is the whole notion that, you know, changing all the parameters manually is kind of okay, but it's kind of hit or miss in terms of whether you're really going to hit the right value, because although you're getting some colorful feedback to kind of guide you towards what the best values are, you know, you're not being exhaustive about it. So we're going to go ahead and use a node called ListMap, which is essentially, if you're in a programming world, you can think of it like a for loop. It just basically is going to iterate through a whole series of different test values, testing each of them, getting a value there, so that we can do what we'll call exhaustively, like finding the what we think the optimal will be. So it's just a very efficient way of going through doing it. We'll talk about even more efficient ways of doing it there, but it's a great way of just kind of testing a whole bunch of different values and getting feedback. Okay, so you get all done with that stuff, you zip it all up, put it out there in the Canvas site as well as, if you can, post the design in the laundry. Okay? Does that make sense? Beautiful. In that case, let us go ahead and dive on in and kind of show you how you get into the question. Yes, Don.
When is she going to have office
hours? Oh, we're just going to, we'll post something this week again. It'll be we'll be here at the end of the day. We'll be here like almost all day tomorrow.
Okay.
Okay. And then we'll probably do it on Friday too. Okay, so we'll post something. That actually turned out to be real helpful last time to kind of sit down with a lot of people individually and kind of work through the assignments or work through your individual projects. Okay, so my guess would be Wednesday afternoon and Friday afternoon.
maybe even Friday morning. We'll see what how that goes. Okay, let us go back and kind of think about where we're going to go today. To start today, where we were going was really this whole notion of optimizing a window overhang based on the sun. And we kind of approached it not too awfully bad off in terms of how we were going to set this up. We were first thing that we would go through and just basically set up some different parameters that would determine the shade of a window overhang. We'd figure out, based on some simple computations using the geometry, really what the overhang value might be. And then we're going to set the parameters to match those things. So let's go into that. My numbering's a little messed up, but we'll get that fixed up. Okay, so if you go on over to 11.1, let's actually take a look at how this all works. I'm going to open up. Let's go out to session 11. We'll say 11.1. And again, we'll sort of take a look at two different things. We'll look at the example, which shows the parametric window kind of hanging out on the side of the building. Okay, so the idea is we have our little building hanging around out here. We have some sun shining down on the building. And really what we would like to do is, no matter where that sun moves to in the sky, always make sure, okay, that the windows are shaded, that we're not getting any sunlight in the windows. And it turns out it's a pretty fair, straightforward calculation in terms of doing that. How we approached that was, if we really just looked at it from the side, he thought about those sun's rays coming on down, really following that yellow line right now. What we can always do is go through and say, hey, if there's some vector coming down from the sun, there's a certain amount of y, or z, for every amount of x. And what we've got to do is just sort of keep those things in proportion. So, down here, if we're going through and computing the depth of the shades, we just have to do that same thing. We just have to make sure that that proportion is the same. And if you do that, then the sun will always be shaded from the sky. We have a slight variation on the theme in that we wanted to say, hey, if it was a very tall window, if it's a tall window that looked more like this, as opposed to having a shade which poked way out here to achieve that angle, maybe we could do it as two shades or three shades to kind of break it up into something that's a little bit more acceptable as opposed to having a big old 5-foot overhang. So that's the scheme that we're after. So just to see it all in action, if you want to go ahead and activate the dynamo and just see how it works, you can go through and let's go ahead and open up in the add-ins Dynamo. We'll just open up, and if you go to, let's go to 11.1. Oh, I'll even go to 3B. We'll just go right to the tail end first, or so you can sort of see how it all works. If I push that away and we run this thing, what you'll see is right now at 12 o'clock, it's looking A-OK for the specific time of year. If, however, I was changing it to a different time of year, this is March 20th, if I change that to be, for example, June 20th, the sun will be higher in the sky. So you'll notice now, okay, that I probably don't need shades that are nearly as deep at that time. The sun is higher in the sky, so the shades could be a little bit more moderate. If you go through and run that, it should go through. And what it did here was it actually shifted back to sort of a single shade, but you can see it's still going through and covering the entire window. So pop it in there. Oops. Okay. Similarly, if I go through and change the sun to a different time of the year, for example, if I change it to December 20th, what's going to happen on December 20th? Where's the sun in the sky on December 20th?
very low in the sky. So what do you think is going to happen to the shades?
Four shades per window.
It could be, if we actually set it up that way. I only allowed for two. But there'll be two very long shades. More like diving boards coming out, something like that.
But we can go through and have our window features adapting parametrically, so no matter what happens, like they're automatically going through and covering as much enough sun. Now, when we talk about shades, this seems a little funny just because it's a hard surface. You might think that as being more of an awning or a piece of canvas or something like that that could stretch out or stretch back. But we could always go through and predict just really where the sun is going to be and where this is going to have to happen.
Okay, so let's go back and build this, because it is pretty straightforward. It started with last time. Oh, we went through and, let me open up Dynamo again, just set up the parameters to go through and build that shade. So for the shade, let me come back over here. We'll open and say, let's just set up the window shade parameters. So the idea is we had a certain amount of, based on the what we wanted the window to be set up as, if we wanted the window to have a certain height and a certain width, we have some sliders that let us change that and kind of change the structure in the model. So we're going to basically just set the parameters of the elements in the model to match those. So we have a height and we have a width. The easiest thing to do there is just go ahead and pull them across.
So you're going to go ahead and here's a value for the height, here's a value for the width.
Okay. We need to tell it what sort of element to go through and adapt that to. So we have the element set up right here. This is selecting all the windows that have that version. And you can pull them in, and then that'll change those different elements so that it adapts those parameter values. So again, I'm going to get that. I'm going to get those. So for all of those windows, we are currently setting now just the height and width. Go ahead and match up sliders, and you can test that if you want, just to sort of see how it works. Actually, this one is so lightweight in terms of what's going on, you could just turn this even into auto, which will make it go a little bit faster. If I go through now and I change the height of the windows, or I go through and change the width of the windows, you can see them changing. Notice my shades aren't changing yet, but you can sort of see the windows changing there. We're going to change the width of the shades next because we're going to need to go through and just do a little calculation.
Just sort of say how high that big that should be.
The algorithm I suggested last time is this. Let's go ahead and say we got a width of a window. That's okay. What if I give it a little bit of an overhang? I say it wants to overhang 1 inch or 2 inch or 3 inches on each side, and we'll compute the width just as the glazing width plus the shading width overhang, and that'll give us the shade width. So. Not to worry. We have this little custom code block set up right down here. It has two input variables, the glazing width. So we'll pop that in over here. Shade width overhang, again, that's just going to be a slider, whatever we choose we want it to be. So if we want it to be like 1 foot, it'll go through and split 6 inches on each side. If we go ahead and change it to be a little bit less, we can make them smaller. But we're going to go through now and just compute a shade width. So if my shade glazing width is 2.6 and the width of the overhang is 0.9, it's going to give us 3.5 as the total shade width. So let's go ahead and set it up in the model so it applies that same parameter. Pulling that over as the value and then pulling the parameter down. So here comes the value. And now let's go ahead and say what parameter that should apply to, or what element it should apply to. So now, with any luck, if you go through and change the width of the overhang, those will get very skinny or get very fat. And if I go through and change the width, they're adapting. Same thing with the height. Although, it's not quite being quite smart just yet. We'll talk about it in a second. So far we're just setting parameters. Let's check in there. That sort of feel pretty good? Looking good? Dom, how's it feeling?
Good.
It's midterm time, so everyone's like particularly tired right now. Okay, so we have those. They're all looking good. The next thing we want to do is just go through and do a little calculation. Just sort of go through and compute from that sum vector how that x and z thing is going to work. So let's see if I have it in this one. I might not have it here. I do have the whole notion of the sun vector. I have the sun settings. That's where it is in the sky. You can see right now it's just reading it from the file. So based upon wherever the sun is set over here, it's going to go through and have the correct altitude and azimuth. It's going to have some sun direction. And what we are going to do is break it up so that we have a sun x, y, and z, because we're just trying to pull the x, y, and z values out of that. We're going to use two of those in just a second. Okay. So if you can, go over to step 1b, and we'll continue. Or 2a, excuse me. Okay, this should all look about the same in terms of what's at the bottom, but let's come up to the top. You might remember that I just went through and computed some x, y, and z values. And what I wanted to do is actually relate those two things together. I want to get the y value and I want to get the z value. And I actually want to just compute the ratio between those. So y over z, because that will sort of give you the relationship between how far out it has that shade has to stick versus the height of the window. So what I'm going to do is compute that ratio, then multiply it times the height, and that will give me then how far the shade should stick up. So I've got a simple ratio in there. I threw in a little fudge factor at the end. You can go ahead and either have it or not. That just sort of says, oh, always make it overlap just a little bit more, so it's not exactly at the value, but there's a little bit of shade that's extending just a little bit further. So that's like that little overage over there. You can take that out if you want to, if you want it to be just precise. So what you can do is say, let's go ahead, let's grab the Y, let's grab the Z. Now the glazing height, that's something we actually kind of have as one of our parameters. So I can say, let's grab that height and bring it over. So now, we know that we should have some sort of size. And currently it's set up to be, well, looks like 25 feet.
Okay. That's because the sun is so low in the sky.
Actually, let me make sure my sun settings are doing the right things. Let's try changing it back to something a little less dramatic. Let's try changing that back to June again. So now, in June, it would only be 4 feet.
Because it's really just based on the vector of the sun and just how low that sun is in the sky at the different times of year.
Again, over here. Pop that down. Say, great. Here we are high in the sky. Whereas if we go back to December, very low in the sky. So if you think about the vector, in this case, the yellow line isn't the right line. It's really this line versus that line. Okay, I'm going to go back to December again, or June. So here's the deal. I've computed my shade depth, and that shade depth is A-okay. I can go ahead and grab that shade depth and use that, plug it right in and set the parameters based on that. But I want to go through and just put a little variation in this. And this is to go through and say, hey, what if there's actually sort of a maximum depth? You know, beyond sticking out 5 or 6 feet, maybe it'll be hard to support it. So maybe I should split it up into a number of segments. Okay, so what we have done is just in the next little block of code, kind of put in a value for what we consider to be the maximum shade depth.
And we're just going to go through and do a little calculation. We're going to compare. How does this number up here compare to that number down there? So if the total of the desired shade depth is less than the maximum shade depth, super, go ahead and use it. If it's greater than, however, than that number, let's go ahead and say take the part that's needed, divide it by two, kind of split it in half. And then we could also sort of have the glazing height. I will split that in half. So I'll put the second shade halfway up. And now, this is sort of based on two. We could even go through and calculate this and say, well, you know, if it really got bad, we might have to divide it into three or four. Okay, but this is a pretty good assumption. So to do that, we're just going to like hook these together. We'll say we have the shade depth that's needed, or the shade overhang that's needed. Plug that in. We'll compare it to 5. Okay, that's always going to give us either a true or a false. Let's see if I can get that to run again. Let me try running that. It says null right now, but it shouldn't be null. That should actually give me a true or a false. That's what I'm sort of wondering about. Oh, because maximum shade depth is not connected. Okay, never mind. Okay, so currently that value is false. It is not greater, so at this point we won't need to use the custom shade or the split shade. If we changed it to be something different, that'll shift to true. In terms of what we would use, we're going to have the shade depth, okay? We're going to say shade overhang needed by 2 and glazing height divided by 2. Shade overhang needed, that we went ahead and have put all the way through there, divided by 2 is 1.9. Glazing height we haven't plugged in yet, so we have to plug that in and we'll be able to figure out what half the window height is. So come back over here. Where did that glazing height go to? It is over here somewhere. Glazing height, right about there, right about there. See if I can pull it over. Okay, so half the height would be 5, half the depth would be 1.9, but right now it's false. So false would mean that it's not going to be used. Okay. Again, if we changed it to later in the year or around December, it would be actually useful. Over here. In February it actually became true. Okay, so this is all just computing what's necessary. We need a little logic now to go through and put some if-thens in there, because if this thing over here is true, then we want to use this new improved shade overhang value divided by 2. If it's not true, we're going to use the other shade overhang value, the value we've already computed over here. So it's either going to be, if true, 8.6, if false, 17 point. Okay. Same thing for the glazing height. If true, it's going to go through and use glazing height divided by 2. If false, it's going to use the plain old glazing height over there.
Okay. So we need a little if-then logic to put this all together, and I happen to have that logic hanging around in 3A. So go over to 3A, and we'll take a look and hook it together.
Like your comments.
What's that?
Thanks for the comments.
All over. I need them too to remember all this stuff. Okay. So I have a couple of different things going on in here.
If this test happens to be true, super. If it's true, I am going to go ahead and pull the shade overhang needed divided by 2. If false, I'm going to pull the shade overhang over here. So that's either going to have one of two values. It's either going to be true and grab this value. If it's false, it's going to grab that value.
I'm going to go ahead and set it up to automatic so you can see it running. Okay.
Okay, so currently, you'll see, because this is true, it is going through and grabbing the half value. If we're false, it would be grabbing that value instead. Okay, so what do we do with that value? In terms of setting the depth, we just say element set parameter by name, and that's where we plug it on in there. So the cool thing about using this if as something to pump the value through is whatever the value is over here, it'll pump it in and use it. So we're going to grab that, set it as the shade depth as the value. It'll always adapt to the true or false. For the element, well, I have to go back and get that window. Where'd that window go? It's way over here. So super. I am taking that window, I am setting its shade depth based on kind of the appropriate value. Okay? And now, if you come on back and check it out in the model, should be looking fairly okay. Now right now, you'll see it's exhibiting the two stage. How that works is just this. We say that if it is true, we are going to go ahead and say that two shades are needed. If it's false, only a single shade is needed. So what I do is, for the height of the second shade, if it's true, I pull the height over here, which is blazing height divided by 2. If it's false, it passes 0 through. So that just sort of says that, hey, there's not going to be a second shade. I can pass those through. Again, for my result, that'll be the value. And the element, we'll be way back over here.
Where did you pull that from?
I pulled it all the way from the element, which is, it's the first over here. That's the actual place where we set that. When we say set parameter by name, and we choose it against a family, then it'll change it for all the instances of that family, as opposed to it being from a specific element, which would only change like the instance value for a single element. So it kind of does okay in terms of what's supposed to be happening here. The idea being now, as you go through and change those things, that would work. How about what else could we do to this? We can definitely go through, and sort of just leave it in terms of splitting it in half. We could go through, and if we really wanted to start getting fancy, we could say that, in terms of computing the number of elements, like this is just going to split in half. You could sort of say, even in here, this is not quite accurate, because the dimension that it's supposed to be right now is 17. I say it's a maximum of 5, but it's only splitting into 2. So I could go through and be a little smarter about that and really say that we're going to divide it not by 2, we're going to divide it by some sort of ratio of this to that. So how can we do that? If we were going to go through and construct a formula, what if it wasn't just 2? What if it is like the number of shades? What can we do to this number and this number over here to actually compute a number of shades required? Any ideas? It's one of those things, if it crosses that threshold, it's almost like we're going to try to figure out, does it cross 5, does it cross 10, does it cross 50, and we're going to figure out how many increments of it crosses. You want a modulo or something like that? That I don't know. Why don't you sort of see? Let's go into search and see if we can find that.
I was thinking a round up function.
Do we have any? It'd be a math sort of function.
Yeah, we do a modulo.
We do? We have math modulo? Let's take a look. What is it under? Or what does the function look like for you? MOD?
Math ceiling might be.
Okay, let's check that out. Returns the first integer greater than the given number.
So it'd be 3.2 segments or over half, is
Oh, that's interesting. Okay, so the first integer greater. Okay, I get, so if we divided those two together, if I divided 70.5 by 5, would that give me the first integer greater? Let's see if we can make that work. I think you might be onto something there. So let's check this. I'm going to do a code block, and I'm going to go just say the what needed length divided by max segment. Check that out. So I got two different values right there. I'll take the needed length and I'll pop that over here. I'll pick the max segment and I'll pop it over here. So that's going to give me this value 3.4. So if I pop that in there to max ceiling, that's actually going to give me 4, which is actually sort of doing what I want. It's always rounding it to the next one. So if I really do believe in 5, I'm going to have to go through and use 4 as opposed to 2 of them. Okay? And if you wanted to go through and do that and use that value, we could go back over here and say that, hey, we're just going to say this by the number of shades, which then makes that an input variable. So I can pop that in. So now it's going to have the 4s instead. Okay, this should actually also be number of shades. So theoretically, I could have 4 of them right now. Now my part isn't smart enough yet. I have to go through and add a little smart system to my part to have an array of elements. Our guy only has 2 shades, but I could make an array that says make 4 of them as opposed to 2. But we'll go ahead and play with that. So now as I go through and let's just test it, if I say my maximum shade depth is 8, for example, okay, looks like for 8 there could actually be 3 of them. If it was 10, there'd be 2 of them. Okay, and we can go through and make that parametric. So we've just given ourselves another layer of parametric control is something we can change. And that's a good thing to do, because if you think about, oh, the whole fact that I said it was 5 feet, you know, who knows? It really depends on the material we're using, it depends on the construction technique. It's nice to allow that whole notion of what the maximum shade depth is to be an input variable. Because then you have a smarter structure based on being able to buy better materials or different manufacturers' parts, so you can sort of approach the problem a little bit differently. Okay, so let's pause there for just a second. In general, this approach is really good for doing things like, you can think about like some sort of a parametric surface element where you're adjusting something, whether it's the height of a peak, or you're computing some value that you can go through and change. You know, you can go through and basically use the sun directness value to always go through and kind of adjust an angle or adjust a degree of overhang to always, you know, on every individual panel, kind of evaluate what the vector value is and then kind of adjust the depth needed as it's needed. So it's, you know, this whole notion of being able to kind of change the parameter values based upon the vector, some aspect of the vector, really powerful. Okay. Let's pause there for a second. Does that kind of make sense? More or less. Okay. Then let us go ahead and shift our attention to another way of approaching this problem. Because, even for this, you recognize that, you know, it's kind of funny about really how this works in that it's always based upon like a specific time. If I said this was 4 in the afternoon, okay, it can go through and adapt it in terms of what's going on. But what's going to happen is even at 4 in the afternoon, like, the equations aren't quite right anymore because, as you move the sun through different points in the sky, that kind of simplification that I put in there in terms of y and z, it's not necessarily right anymore. The shadow is kind of heading off in that direction. And that's really the essence of where we need to kind of think about adapting and improving our analysis in a lot of these different cases is that it's not good enough to just kind of look at a single point. It's okay to look at a single point and kind of evaluate that. But what you really tend to be more interested in is just the total behavior over a whole range of points in time and different dates. Okay? So to do that, we often switch over to something called solar analysis. And solar analysis is a little bit better because solar analysis has a tool that will go through and just look over a range of values and a range of times and go through and compute things in a better way. So let's go ahead and to play with that, if you can, go ahead and open up. It's actually 11.3. I'm going to skip there right now, just because I think it'll be more helpful to you for what you have to do. And if you can, let's go ahead and open up. You can open up solar analysis, sloping roof. See what's going on over here. Hey, check out my little kind of field of buildings here. The idea is, and this is a fairly common situation, I got a little building that I'm trying to build. It's surrounded by many other buildings. And I'd like to sort of think about really what I need to do with that roof or how much sun is going to be hitting that building. And it's part of the whole field of buildings. There's a lot of stuff going on around here. Okay, so just going through and computing a single vector, again, won't be enough because that would be for a specific point in time. But you can imagine that, early in the morning, if the sun is coming from this direction, these buildings might be shading it. Later in the middle of the day, it might be this building that's shading it. Later in the afternoon, it might be this building that's shading it. So you really want a more accurate model that kind of reflects how all these different things work at different points in time. So to play with this, just so you know a little about what's happening in the background here, I have a little part. There's a family. It's actually in there in the folder, or you can just edit it here if you want to. Say just choose it and edit the family. I got a little parametric family. We'll see if we'll open this up. That'll just let me sort of change the height of the building. So in this one, I could change like the base height. So for example, I could go through and kind of raise the whole building base height. I can go through and also change the roof slope. And this is the one that might be interesting to us. We spent a lot of time here talking about solar panels and what the optimal slope will be to go through and kind of catch the sun. And this is something that might let us evaluate that, because when you think about this building that has a sloped roof, or you know, it's just solar panels that are kind of sloped on a flat roof. But it'll let us test those and just kind of vary that. Okay, so let's go back over to the example and think about how to approach this. Because there is a tool called solar analysis, which actually makes it pretty easy to go through and evaluate these, and we like to tap into that tool. But like most things Dynamo, let's always start by just sort of understanding how it behaves in Revit. Okay, because you know, you have to see, it sort of depends on the modeling engine and the geometry that's going on there. You almost always have to be able to get it to work manually before you can go ahead and automate it. So it's really just testing to see, are we understanding the behavior of this analysis tool and what it provides? And how we can check that out is under the Analyze tab. You should find something called Solar for creating a solar analysis. If you don't see solar kind of installed on your machine, it just means we need to sort of install a plugin on your machine to make that available. So let's see, do most people have that? Lama does. How are you, Jacqueline? Do you have that? Excellent. Andrew?
Nope.
You got it?
I have to download it.
Okay, you're downloading it? Okay, go for it. You can either download Insight 360 or Lighting Analysis for Revit. And John, do you have that?
What is it?
It's under the Analyze tab.
No.
Okay, easy fix. Let's go ahead and show you where you can get that. Go to let's see if I can find it here. Let's try Insight 360 plugin. Experience it, that's fine, but where do I download it?
It's the third link.
What's that?
I think it's the third name.
Oh, down in here?
No.
Oh, in the list?
Yeah, in the list.
Okay, hang on. Under Insight 360 plugin.
There's first on Google for me, just Google Solar Analysis Revit.
Let's show that.
Yeah. Purple one works.
First one? Hang on.
Escape.
forget my Googling skills. But that's all that. Oh, hang on. I just gotta find where the download link is.
If you don't have it installed, it'll give you a little unresolved form design mode.
So it's the lighting?
Yes, it's actually, it's built into the lighting analysis tool. Oh, there, download the installers, go right there. Revit 2016. Okay, so if we went over to Lighting Analysis Revit, you go ahead and choose for Revit 2016. What you'll do is, it'll download, it's actually a very small little installer. It's not very big at all. But what you'll do is you will go ahead and run it, and on your machines here, at some point, it'll probably ask you for a username and a password to install it. At which point, you go ahead and plug in the ever so secret username and password that no one would ever guess. Which is conveniently posted on the wall. Let's see if you can get that thing installed. Yes, no. Yes. Okay, good. Okay, going? Andrew, you going? I'm good?
Still looking.
Okay, no worries. Let me show you how this thing works. Okay, the idea is we got our field of buildings that are looking pretty good here. We'd like to sort of know about the sun that's hitting any of these different surfaces, but in particular, I'm going to be paying attention to that one there. The idea is you go through and choose the surfaces that you want to consider to be in the analysis. As you think about solar analysis, it's very important. It's going to depend on the location on the face of the Earth. It's going to depend on, what time range you want to consider. So let's think about some of those different things. If you want to change the location on the Earth, we'll say under Manage, let's go to Location. And let's put this somewhere. I put it in Tempe, Arizona, on the campus of ASU. Or we can go ahead and put it somewhere else. What else is a good sunny spot? Any nominations?
Miami.
We'll go for Miami. Again, this will just help us get a latitude and longitude. Okay, if we were actually doing the weather analysis right now, we'd kind of be more careful about choosing a specific weather station. But for the most part, most of Greater Miami has very similar latitude and longitude, so that's okay. Super. We are also going to think about what time we're interested in considering. Here's sort of an interesting thing in terms of sun settings. If you go down to that little guy, looks like the sun, and you choose the sun settings, you sort of get an idea of really what you can choose. We can go through and there's a single still time, okay, which is like a little snapshot, but that's not really useful for what we want to do right now. We can think about a single day. A single day would be at a specific location, kind of on that date, kind of for a specific time. We'd go through and say a time range or sunrise to sunset. That'd be good for just a single day. And that'd be okay if you were just kind of trying to figure out how the sun was varying through the course of a single day. Multi-day is probably a little more interesting for what we're after. You say multi-day, you get the choice of everything from a one-year study. If you really want to think about just how the sun is, what your total ability to collect solar energy is for the entire year. You can also go through and just choose a season. If you only care about the summer, or you only care about the winter, something like that. So for what I'm doing, I'm going to just go ahead and choose the one-year study.
See, it'll go from 1-1 all the way to 12-31. We can say sunrise to sunset. We want to make sure, or only consider 10 to 4. Sunrise to sunset's probably a little bit better. There's this whole issue here, really, how accurate you want it to be. You're going to do it every hour, every day. For us, well, let's go ahead and keep it fairly accurate. We're going to go through and kind of just compute this every hour. So, for people who've taken classes where you compute something like that, how many hours are there in a year?
8,760.
Okay, a number that will forever be like emblazoned in your brain. Okay, so we'll go through and consider that. So super, we are all set. When you want to do the analysis, that's a spurious message. I always ignore that one. Okay, when you want to do the analysis, okay, everyone got the tool now?
Yeah.
Super. You say solar, and we get a choice. Let's talk about what we can do here. In terms of what's going on here, we can say basically all the roof surfaces, which are kind of proper roofs in Revit's mind. These are all just masses, though, so it doesn't really know what's a roof and what's a wall, so I'm just going to say all the mass faces. Okay? We also get to sort of choose what kind of study we want. I'm going to choose custom, and even there I could sort of choose some settings in here. For the analysis period, I'm just going to use the sun settings. So that's going to use all year. It's going to go through, it's showing me some of the different evaluations it's going to do. It's going to report EUI for me in terms of kilowatt hours per meter square. We can start changing some of those things. Let's change the analysis grid settings. This is really, as we're considering it, how many different points should be considered? It's going to do a 12-foot grid, so that'll go through and have a fairly high degree of accuracy. We can make it more coarse or more fine. We can also set some of these other things. If we want to go through and just sort of say, what are the surfaces where we would have the ability to pay back on solar panels in a certain period, we can adjust those settings. But we're just going to compute the values now. So great, I say all mass faces, that looks good. For the results, I have different ways I can look at it. I'm just going to say, let's do the cumulative insulation. Okay, save it the solar analysis default. That's just sort of a color scheme, but let's run this and see what happens. Doesn't look like it did anything. Oh, there it goes. It's a running. It's a computing. Okay, so let's take a look at what's going on here. Okay, you're looking at a lot of color. Anyone care to interpret?
Yellow is no sun.
Yep.
Yellow is
no
sun,
yeah. Excellent. So we got a range there. And how do you make out some of these funny like purple zones? For example, this is kind of a funny looking surface over here. What's going on there? Because it doesn't look like it has the same sun on all the surface. So what's going on? Yeah. It's being shaded by this building in front at different times of the year and different angles. So in the middle, let's say it's very dark. It's getting some light on the side. I get some light over there. This building over here with my sloping roof, it's kind of down in the gulch. So it's surrounded on all sides. The walls don't get very much at all. What else can we do here? This building over here, you see it's shaded a fair amount too. So when you do all the mass faces, the deal is you get a range of values here, and we can sort of adjust the scaling on this, but it's going to show us from the worst to the best. Okay, all the different values. So let me kind of spin that around and take a look. You'll sort of see that if I spun on over to the north side, it's all purpley back there. It's kind of very yellowy in here. Okay, so there's a range of values, and those range of values are scaled based on the highest and lowest. There actually is absolute data behind all this. Let's see if I can zoom on out and find there's actually a scale in here somewhere. I think I see it right over there.
Existing
Okay.
How is this one different from what we used before?
It's actually very similar. No, it's just another, it's another variation. It's all the same calculations. It's another variation on a tool that they think is going to try and make it a little bit easier. Because it used to be a separate plugin. Now it's kind of very alive in this.
What's
that? Oh, if you zoom on out,
oh, I see.
Say ZO, and it might be hanging over there in a funny place. Let me try. I'm even going to change the scale of my drawing to be like, oh, like a 32nd or something like that. I think, yeah, it'll make the relative, the scale of the drawing will adjust the size of how big the legend shows up relative to the actual drawing here. Okay, so everywhere from 0 to 2. Now, as you think about this, the analysis actually can be adjusted so that the range is a little more refined. Like, right now we're considering all these buildings over here. It's all the faces, so the highest values are the ones out here. If you wanted to consider like a subset of the faces and just really get a finer range set of values, what tends to happen is the roofs, or these surfaces which are facing directly to the south, they're really just sort of scaling the high end very high, so we're not getting much subtlety in some of the other buildings. If I chose just some of the other buildings, for example, I said solar, and as opposed to all mass faces, I said, let's select some faces. Close that up. This is sort of confusing. That's why that dialogue comes up. You are in a mode where we're going to choose some faces, and we have to say finish at the tail end. And this one always gets us. You get in there, you start choosing faces, and you can't figure out why you can't get out. So if I just want to look at some faces of some of the buildings, I think I actually got the base there. So no, I didn't. That's good. Maybe even the face of this building over here. Okay, so I have some of the faces selected, but not all the faces. And if I say finish, I can now run this. Doing its thing. Arrgh. No, that's not right, because it's showing me everything.
Except the faces are selected.
Oh, how very odd. Ooh, this makes me wonder. This makes me wonder. Let's try this again. I'm wondering if I'm flipping the order in the wrong way. That's good. Yes, it is.
That's what I think. Mm-hmm.
Well, that's certainly annoying. I want to say, actually, let me try this. Let me go through all. Okay, actually. Well, it happened to be on screen, something off screen, something magic happened. I just clicked and act outside and it unfolded through the wall. Okay, that's a little bit better. So let's go ahead and we'll again choose this one and that one. Okay, super. Oh, I have to finish over here. See? I try to pretend like I make all these mistakes just to demonstrate. Yeah. It's a good lie. Well, we'll see if you believe it. They figured out so far that it's not true. Okay, so it's a little bit different in terms of the zero and the purple, but you can definitely see on this range, you know, there's a certain place that would be much more favorable for trying to place solar panels or do something of the surface that I gave it to work with. Okay. But the idea is we got a range of values, so we're going to always sort of like, you know, try to use this kind of data as opposed to sort of the single isolated value. Okay. Now, just so you understand what it actually returns a whole grid of values. And if you wanted to, you could actually go through and export the Excel spreadsheet that includes all those. Actually, you might even be able to sort of see it in here. I'm just trying to see in here, show grid lines, show contour. I could sort of change the way this all appears a little bit, but no, that's not it. What I want to do is to actually show you there's actually a range of values in here. So if I say export that, it'll actually go off to Excel and do something for me. I'm going to sample solar data. I'll just put it on my desktop for now. If I go out there and take a look for that, see if I can find Excel in here. Let's do a little open. I'll see if I can find that sample solar data. Where did it go? To my desktop? Oh, you know what it is? It's a CSV file, which is a little bit strange. I have learned in Excel now what I have to do is open this and go to data. And what do I have to say? From text. And import it. It's a limited file, yada, yada, yada. Start import. File origin, my dad has headers, it actually does. It's a delimited file. It's actually comma delimited. So if you're feeling analytical, you can actually get all these values. What it's doing is for various x, y, z's that have different normals, it's going through and giving you these insolation values. So you can start averaging those, I can sum them, I can put them in, I can find the max. That's going to be, what is it? It's kilowatt hours per meter squared. There's one other thing in there somewhere. I'm very bad about my units.
Me too.
Exactly. Okay, so yeah, you get all these values. So we want to go through and use that because what we'd like to do is for our various surfaces say, hey, these values are pretty precise. They're not just some directness values. They're actually solar that's hitting. So let's go ahead and figure out how we can go through and use those. Okay, so what we are going to do. Oh, you're welcome.
Really
thank you for joining us.
It's been
hope
really
to see
cool.
you soon. Okay. Let's go back over. Okay, so what we're going to do is say, can we use these? And it turns out there is a fantastic plugin available to help you do these things. So this very same thing that you are doing in like Revit, you want to be able to kind of access from Dynamo and use these values. And the way we get to that is there's a solar analysis plugin to Dynamo. So let's go off and take a look at it. Where you actually find it is, let me go back over to Dynamo. Where'd it go? Dynamo. Add-ins. Okay. By default, the solar analysis plugin is not installed, but that's something you can fix pretty easily because it is available as a package to you. So what we're going to do is, this is a starting point, this is new. Get a new little file, not much going on there so far. Okay, I am going to say, oh, I'll type in solar analysis, and you'll see that I have something that says solar analysis analyze. You probably don't have that yet, and that's because we need to install it. Yeah, I'm good.
The solar tool that you showed us, where you were able to convert it into an Excel file,
yeah.
Does it also work the other way? Can you bring in an Excel file?
And then just map it?
Yeah, the insulation values that are available.
You could, yeah. It's sort of another thing. It's sort of, it's not generated within, but if you we can read an Excel file and then grab those values and then map them as colors or something like that.
Oh.
Yeah. No. It's like, it opens up possibilities for you. Okay, if you don't have solar analysis, not to worry, that's an easy thing to fix. You are going to grab a package that has it, and how you find that is you go to the packages menu and you say search for a package, and this is where you find all those cool things that aren't built into Dynamo. So in terms of analysis, there's good things for finding things like solar, there's good packages for going off to structural analysis packages and kind of launching some structural analysis on whatever you have drawn. There's a whole trade in trying to put together packages that connect us to other types of analysis tools. So go ahead and type in just solar. And you might have to type in solar or solar analysis, but you'll actually find one right in the middle of my screen here. It says solar analysis for Dynamo. And that is the one we want. It actually comes from the Dynamo team, so that's actually the guys who,
really maintain the code that's the core of all this. You'll see it was updated January 29th, 2016, so that sounds pretty good in terms of being fresh. You know, sort of always, you know, you want things that are relatively fresh. There's some older ones like Reed Solar Installation Data, Ian, the same author did that, but that was back in 2013. So, yeah, I don't know, that one might not work anymore. There's sort of this thing in the open source community where you have to kind of keep up to date all the time. Interesting. I should check out Ladybug. It's a plugin for weather data and environmental analysis. Brand new. We'll see. Okay, so go ahead and click the little download button, the thing that looks like the arrow with a big circle around it, and see if we can get that loaded into your machine. Now, this is going to bring up kind of an issue of like how you go through and when you download these packages, how do you know what they do? Because there's all this information theoretically hanging around there, but it doesn't really give you very much. It's like solar analysis, analyze, what do I do with that? You choose it. It's a little bit of documentation in there, but you know, not a whole lot. So here's the hidden secret of Dynamo packages. It turns out when you put a package together and you kind of send it off into the world and share it, you typically go through and bundle up some examples of how to use it, which are really useful for someone else. Okay, so where those exist is if you, for example, say packages and manage the packages, here's my little solar analysis. There's actually a menu there. You can say show the root directory. And what that does is it just shows me where the extras are stored because they're buried alive, but they're buried alive deep inside the bowels of Dynamo. But if you say show the root directory, okay, you'll see there's actually a directory here. And it turns out this extra folder is the place where you tend to find all the goodies. So it's typically inside that extra folder. And we can take a look in there. They have some Revit files that look like they were part of the analysis. They have one that says solar analysis in Revit N. Okay, that's a file which demonstrates, you know, just the scripting and all the linking to the different nodes. So that's the one we're gonna open. Okay, so let's see if you can open that. Will it let me do that? If it doesn't, I'm just going to, it looks like it's just showing me. Cancel that. What I'm going to do is just grab the path. And then I'll say open. It's kind of a cool trick of basically grabbing the path. And then you can open it up. And you'll see an example that they've put together. But don't worry about this one because I'm going to show you one that's a little bit simpler. It's still a little complicated in terms of what's going on.
How do you grab the path? You select it.
What you do is it's kind of interesting. Yeah. You when you say let's go through and show the path, what you got to do is you just come up to the Windows bar, the little Windows address bar, and you can copy it. Who knew? So there is in this example, okay, a whole kind of node grouping that shows a lot of variations in terms of how you can use it and stuff like that. So very often this is a great way to dig in and start to see how it works. Actually, I took this and reduced it a little bit, kind of made it a little less complicated so we can use it. So if you want to open that one, we'll talk about the functionality and kind of the core of the functionality. It's got a lot of functionality in it, but in specific, we want to look at just there's sort of an essence that'll be most useful to you. So if you go back over to see session 11, and you say, I want to look at 11.3, let's say solar analysis start, 1A. let's just kind of walk around these nodes and we'll talk about how we're going to hook them up together. So we'll start in the middle, which is actually the core of the analyze node. So you'll see we have an analyze node hanging around in here. It wants several inputs. It wants to know the weather. It wants to know which surfaces you want to analyze. It wants to know which surfaces are shading surfaces. Okay. And it also wants to know what time frame you want to have considered. Okay, so not today. Weather is something that we can feed it a weather file. If you have a weather file, you compute it for a specific, you know, location if you want. Or you can just get the weather file that's currently associated with the site location. Okay, and that's okay. So if you're in Miami or Abu Dhabi or wherever you are, you can say, let's do it based on what weather it has. So we have this notion of a site location. And we can say weather by location, and then it'll download and find some weather for that location. That's going to be a piece of it. We're going to say, let's get some analysis surfaces. For that, we're just going to have to go through and select some surfaces to analyze. And I'm going to select that rooftop, that sloping rooftop. We want to select some shading surfaces. And this can be a whole list of surfaces. I can go through and select a bunch of faces, or I can select individual faces and put them into a list. But ultimately, you want a list. In fact, even the surfaces to analyze can be a list if you want to, as opposed to a single one. Okay. Finally, there's time study. Time study, we're actually going to go through and add a Revit sun settings. Okay. Just say let's grab the start time and the end time and basically make a time study from that start time to that end time. Okay, so that's basically just grabbing things from Revit. But we'll show you that you can change that a little bit too. Okay. At the tail end, what this thing actually returns is it's going to give you a whole just really grid of values. Okay, because it's going to break up the world into a grid. In fact, what it does is it breaks up the world based on the spacing in terms of feet, 4 feet by 4 feet, 10 feet by 10 feet, whatever you need. And if we want to go through and get the cumulative values, okay, cumulative values would be all the sun calculated on that point throughout the entire year. Average would be not the total, it'd be the average of all the values. So the highs and the lows would sort of average out against each other. Peak would be the absolute highest value. So not necessarily all at the same time, but the highest at any time during the year and all those different grid points. Okay, so let's pause there for a second. Does that sort of make sense in terms of what it does? Indeed. Then let us go ahead and try to use this thing. So for the weather, that's pretty good. Let's go through and say that. Actually, let me just do a run first. We'll sort of break it first, but it'll start. Let's go through and we can see we have some sort of location. Looks like we're Miami Beach, Florida. That's looking good. Then we're gonna come over here and we have some weather. So it looks like it's gone through and found some weather station for us that's close to Miami Beach. So that's pretty good. If that's looking good, let's pull that weather on down. Check one. Next up, we have to figure out some surfaces that we want to analyze. And I'm just selecting faces here. There's other ways where you can select masses and pull all the masses, faces off the masses, but I'm going to keep it simple for us right now. If I just want to go for a single face, look at all that. I still have some old stuff hanging around in here. These analysis results, I should comment about them. They're actually an object, so you can either delete them or hide them if you want to. Okay, but I'm going to say let's select a face to analyze. And let's see if we can go ahead and grab that top surface right there. Okay. With any luck, after you select a face, you'll get some sort of ID number here of the ailment. Is that? Oh, let's check it out. Is that on the select face or on where? Did you just try reselecting the face?
Yep.
Interesting. Let's try it again. Let's see what's going on.
That is the masses, the objects.
Let's see what we got here. Change. And it's doing that?
Okay. It says, lots prepared to run this node and copy the problem.
Yeah, let's go ahead and just take it out and we'll put it in select face again.
Okay.
Yeah, because so, sometimes they break. How about you, Don, that work for you? Yeah. Okay. And Lemma, for you?
It's getting an error over here.
That's okay. We're going to get to that. That's later. Okay.
Good.
That's a comment. It's just somewhere in the way, you know, on the color side, we haven't given it something it needs yet. Okay. So, I got a surface to analyze. Now we're going to go out and grab some faces that are going to be the shading surfaces. So now, okay, there's no penalty, it's a little time, but there's no penalty in selecting a lot of faces. But when you say select faces as opposed to select face, what happens is back over here in Revit, you're in that multiple finish cancel mode. So this is where I got myself in trouble last time. Okay, so go ahead and start selecting some faces. And in terms of things that I think are going to shade this, maybe that side will shade it. I don't know if that'll shade it. We'll see. I think that'll probably shade it. That'll shade it. That'll shade it. I can grab some others. Maybe that side over there will shade it too. But I'm just adding them in there. Okay, and everything that you consider to be a shading surface, I'm just going to add it in there. So I think I've gotten all the faces of the buildings around it. Okay, I could get the roofs here, but it turns out the roofs really aren't, because, I don't know. I shouldn't say that so cavalierly. I think the walls will go ahead and do all the blocking, that the roof will sort of be irrelevant, but I could grab the roof faces too. Okay, when you're done, say finish. Okay, so when you're all done, if you want to even sort of run this, let's try this. I'll say, oh, actually over here in Dynamo, you'll actually see a nice little model, which shows your selected geometry. It doesn't look like my sloping surface is there. I got everything else. I think I got it there. Try again. I think I got it, but we'll see to make sure. Certain. Come over here. Over there. Okay. Next up, we are going to start connecting these things together. We're going to take these faces and those faces and pull them on over. So let's go ahead. Oh, even the flatten, I'm not 100% certain it's needed, but I just wanted to make sure there was no hierarchy in the whole thing. So I just wanted to get a single list of surfaces. Yeah, I don't have a watch on this. I could watch it. I don't think that flattens absolutely necessary, but it's not harming anything either. Okay, so I'll take those over as the shading surfaces. I'll take that over as the analysis surface. Now, the only thing still missing right now is some time frame to use for our study. So we're going to grab the sun setting, say what the start time is, and the ending time. And you'll see, oh, in the existing Revit settings. Yeah, Dom, what you got?
I'm having an error as well, and I deleted it, and I put it back
in. In the select faces, or which one?
Yeah, select faces.
OK, and now what?
I need to talk to that owner for
that. It ain't me. OK, let's go ahead and I'll just take out the node. And what happened? Did you put it back in again?
Yeah, I did.
And it's still having errors?
Yep.
Try again. I'm just very curious. You say select faces. Come on over there and let's try grabbing a couple. Okay, what happens now when I say finish? Yeah, so it looks good, but then when you run it, it sort of barfs. What happens there? Interesting. Don't know. This is something where I would say the Dynamo is acting very strange and peculiar. That node shouldn't work. At this point, typically what I'll do is just kind of quit out of Revit and bring it back up. I think there's probably just something in Dynamo's memory that's a little flaky. But yeah, this is definitely one, and I'll advise it for everyone. Like, when Revit just starts fighting you in a very irrational way, don't assume you're wrong. You know, it could be that there's just something weird going on.
because there's no specific reason why it should work for you, not work for you, when you're working for your neighbors. Yeah.
So watch out.
Everything's experimental around here. Okay, so you got those surfaces, you got this time. In terms of time, you'll see that for the start time, it pulled that out of the Revit information. I'm on January 1st. Looks like 3 p.m. Oh. Here's the end time.
That's really strange. Let's go back and see what my sun settings are. I think I'm sort of goofing. Those don't look like good sun times.
Come on over.
That should be 11 to 11. Although I'm wondering about if it's doing something. Oh, you know what I bet it's doing? I bet it's doing the whole GMT thing. Because see how it says 3 p.m. and.
Yes. Okay. January 1st at 3, because I'm over at January 1st at 3 p.m. If I think about Greenwich Mean Time, and it's the middle, so is it 9 hours ahead? See, that's actually midnight. Somewhere else.
So I think that's what's going on there. But that's why in the whole, hang on, pop this up. Place where we're doing the time setup, you have the ever popular use daylight savings time. That's true. I'm pretty sure it's doing Greenwich Mean Time. That's interesting. We'll see. Also, I have this whole date and time. If I don't want to use the sun settings out of Revit, I could just go ahead and put in some of the dates and times. So I did it that way. Okay, but go ahead. We have that time study. Let's just kind of see what it says right in there. It's just a time study. It's hard to tell what's going on there. We're going to pull that time study in over here. And we are ready to rock and roll. Now, again, what's available to us are, we have the degree of coarseness that we want the grid to be refined at, so we can change the spacing, make it bigger. So we have a very big model that might be a useful thing to do. We also have this whole issue of, do we want to rotate the project? And even this is kind of what I left this in that. That's what the team had actually put in there. They're computing radians to degrees, but then when I go to project rotation, it says it wants degrees. So I'm not really sure. We're going to leave it at zero, so it's not going to affect our analysis. But we might have to do a little experimentation if we're going to play with that to see, is it, you know, 30 degrees or is that 30 in radians? Because I don't know. But in the spirit of things, that's the way things are sort of in this world. It's a little loose around the edges. So you have to go through and be very careful sometimes. Confirm that the data that you're getting back or the values you're getting back agree with your intuition, because if they don't, which is why using the homology principle, you always start with something so incredibly simple that you can anticipate and confirm the behavior before you go into something complicated, because you have to make sure you're using the tool properly or the tool's using you properly before you actually go through and twist it in a whole lot. So we have some solar radiation values. We're ready to run. So you can go through and let's pull out some different things. Oh, how about, I'm gonna put a couple of watches in here just so we can sort of see some things. How about if I go through, let me watch the cumulative values. Let me watch the average values. Maybe I'll even go through and watch the peak values, just so you get a sense of those. So for the full year, we're going to sort of see what the cumulative values are. I expect those to be pretty big. It's going to add up a bunch of numbers for the entire year. Average versus peak. I tend to think that the peaks will be bigger than the averages, just because it'll be the high without averaging out the lows. So let's check it out. I'll do a little running.
Okay, still got a warning, but it's hanging out down here. So what do I got in here? I got a bunch of zeros. That doesn't look too good. Let's see if we can get down to someplace where somewhere on the grid there's anything more. Is my grid all zeros? Does anyone have things that are other than zeros? What is going on here? Let's think about this. That doesn't look like it's doing any good at all. Let's go back and try some changing something and see if we can sort of get those to be a little more accurate about what we want. Go back over here. Since we could think of several different things. It could be something about the face not being right in terms of the analysis surface, although I thought I got the analysis surface. It could be something about the time frame. So let's try doing something with our time frame. Confirm that.
Those dates that you have separate there.
Yep. Okay. Was that?
Those dates that you have separate
yes.
down there, I put those in and now it has numbers.
And now it has numbers. Okay. So through excellent debugging, we have figured out that it seems to be something about our time frame. So let's go ahead and think about this. Even from like us 3 in the afternoon to 1, maybe that's not there. So if you went through and put in, let's just kind of try that as a starting point. So you're putting in January 1st. Oh, so did you change them a little? It's June 1st. Let's say it's June 1st at like 8 a.m. Sort of understood, I think. And let's say it's going to be September 30th, 2015 at like 6 p.m. Not very computer science-y, but let's see what happens if I run those. Ah, well, that certainly gave us some values. Let's check it out. So, I'm somewhere down at the bottom of my list here somewhere. What you're seeing is that the totals look like, oh, what do I have here? I have like a 90 days or something like that. I'm in the 400,000 sort of range in terms of the totals. For the average, I'm getting these numbers in the 300 to 400 range. For the peak, I'm getting these numbers in the 800 range. And that sort of makes sense. Because, you know, somewhere through the year it's probably zero, other places it's 800 at the peak, so the average is probably in the middle. If I took those 400s and multiplied it by all the hours and all those days, I'd probably get close to 500,000. Actually sort of makes sense. It's around 1,000. Increments of it or something like that. So at least at first blush, it seems to be doing about the right thing. Now, in terms of the number of points, what it's done is it's taken my analysis surface and it's divided it up in 4x4 grids. Okay, so based on the size of that, it looks like I currently have about 50 rows and, oh, I don't know how many points per row. Maybe about like 16 points per row, something like that. So I got a lot of data values in here. In terms of the points, you can actually see what all the calculation points are in terms of the actual x, y, like z values. So let's come on in here. Here's the actual points, the x, y, z values. And this count over here is just saying this is counting the number of points. So it's like there are 1,750 points in the grid right now. And this is based on the analysis surface. So that's being computed. Okay. So we have a lot of information in here, but let's go ahead and try to use this. So if we were going to, and we have all these cumulative values, we have our average and our peak values, try to do something interesting,
One thing we might try to do is do a little colorization. You know, I always like to colorize surfaces and kind of show how things are appearing over there. So let's think what you can do. There is a function that our friends on the Dynamo team built, which looks like this. It's actually a pretty nice function. It's basically making a series of different lists. It's saying, I want to find something that's blue, which is going to be color RGB with the blue component at 255. It's going to make an orange color, which has, what is it here, the green and the blue. I don't sense of where the alpha is, it's funny. And red, so it's a red of an alpha of 255, a red of 255, green, blue, or zero. This is red and yellow, or red and green, and that's only on the blue. Although it's interesting to me why that one's zero. The blue would be very transparent in this case, as opposed to being very kind of. But we're saying color is a collection of red, blue, red, orange. And indices are 0, 0.5, and 1. What that's doing is saying, take the blue value, map it with 0. Take the red value, map it with 0.5. Take the orange color, and map it to 1. And we should have a color range coming out of that. So this is really taking a lot of what we did in that other node and just putting it together in one big old chunk. Don't worry if this is like a little confusing in terms of the way it's set up right now. We can map it just the way we did last time, in terms of blue to red, or whatever the values are. So this is our color range. Let's see what else they're doing in here. They are taking our list of values, and we're doing sort of an interesting thing to it. So let's think, what do we want to scale? Do you want to do the cumulatives, or what do you think is going to be most interesting? OK, let's go to the cumulatives. What we're going to do is take the cumulatives, and what they're going to do is do a little scaling, and here's what they're going to do. They're going to say, let's grab the maximum item, okay? Then we're going to take any individual item and divide it by the max, okay? So you're always going to get, again, a value of, like, you know, something between 0, you know, 0 and 1. You're always going to get a scaled value. So I'll take those cumulatives. I'm going to flatten it. The only reason I need to flatten it is currently it's in a big list, it's in a grid where it has like rows and columns. And when I want to go through and find the max, I actually just want it to be a single list. So that's what flatten's doing. It's just going to take that list that's in rows and columns and return a single flat list with all 1,700 points on it. List maximum is going to be the highest value. It looks like somewhere in that list, somewhere, there's a 535,000. Okay. And what this is going to do is if I take those as n and I divide them by max, then I'm going to get just basically a scaled series of values. So take those cumulative values, divide them by the max. And now we are ready to basically show up a whole list of. Divided values like that. Actually, let me do this. Let me take the flattened list. I think that's what I need to do instead. That'll give it to us without all the values. Okay, so the idea is what I want to do is take all those different values, plug them into a color range so I can go through and get colors associated with all those values from 0 to 1. You'll see now it's going to go ahead and compute it everywhere from the blue to the red to the orange. And what that's going to return at the tail end is really just a whole lot of color values. Oops,
pulled the values out wrong. You come back. Okay, so now I have a whole series of the color values that are a little bit different. So the final step in all this is if you would like to take those color values and actually map them back to the surface, you would have to feed it the surface and those color values, and then we should be okay. So take the colors. Let me go way back over here and get the surface. It's right here. Okay. And now, if I roll on in there, you can sort of see the surface. And there's a whole bunch of different color values across the surface just based upon, you know, the cumulative radiation. Let's pause and finish up here today just thinking about what is the solar radiation node doing for us? Because compared to the directness values, in a lot of ways, it's kind of very similar. Hang out here. What the solar radiation analysis node is doing is it's giving us a whole bunch of values, which are the true values for the insulation, either the peaks or the cumulatives or the averages, but it's true values. You know, to consider that entire grid, you know, if we had a bunch of surfaces, we can get values on grids across all the different surfaces. But these numbers are really useful to us in that we can go through and for any surface, we can figure out what the highest is, if we want to do the color range, we can figure out what the average value is across all those different points and sort of come up with an average rating for the surface. Okay. And then use that as a way of sort of evaluating the surface. But what we're really just trying to do is come up with ways of evaluating all the different surfaces, you know, based on the geometry, so that we have some understanding, you know, is it good or bad? So, for example, this thing right now, if I just went through and came up with a single evaluation, I could say list.average. Got it? Average? Mean? Math average. So if, for example, I fed in this list of numbers and said there was an average, I could say that the average is 50 point blah, 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 yada, yada, yada. And that's an evaluation for this surface right now in terms of the total insulation. Okay. Where this is going and where we will take it next time is, this is a fantastic analysis, a very accurate analysis for the case where this structure has a 30 degree roof slope. But it would be very interesting to go through and start changing this number around a little bit to say, what if it was 10 degrees? What if it was 15? What if it was 20, 25, 30? And try to figure out if we could, for each of those different degree values, come up with the average insulation or the total cumulative insulation, however you want to look at it, you know, and put all of those together, we could actually try to figure out what we think is the optimum slope of that to actually catch the most sun or avoid the most sun or whatever it is you're trying to drive. And that's what we're trying to do, and that's what you're going to do in the assignment, is basically go through and grab these numbers, and based on these numbers, you're going to go through and try changing, okay, 30 was great, what's 45 look like? What's 50 look like? Okay, try to see if you can come up with what you think the average is. But what we'll do next time in class together is we'll say, let's use a function called a list map, where we take all this evaluation and we take this idea of changing the roof slope, put these lists all in the giant node, and just say, let's just keep on changing the roof slope, compute it for each different degree value, get those numbers for each of the different degree values, so you can figure out what you think the absolute best is. Okay, and that's where we're going just in terms of optimization, that
color feedback is good, we can do all sorts of things based on the evaluations. Now we're going to want to start saying, what if we parametrically change your structure and get a whole bunch of evaluation values? How do we zoom in on the one that you think is most interesting? Okay, beautiful. Let us adjourn for there for today. But if you can, start playing around with your structure, if you're going to use your structure or kind of come up with a different one. But see if you can just start getting things to flex a little bit based on computing some evaluation values, first just with the vectors, and then see if we can actually get some surfaces so that we can feed a whole range of surfaces. In fact, we'll do that in class next time. We'll take a structure that's panelized and feed all of the panels into this so that you can start to see, you know, if you get a whole bunch of evaluations, how you add them all together. Okay, Yudi, let us adjourn.